When we said you were coming on the show, lots of people have very sort of granular questions about the paid rides. So let's start there. You know, what is the average distance taken, the average fare per ride, and a bit more about the economics of what you've achieved?
Yeah, thank you so much, Ed, for having me. And I would love to hear more about your experience because I've been watching your social engagement like so many of our riders. So you said it, you know, we've reached over 100,000 rides per week across San Francisco, Phoenix, and Los Angeles. Those, the distances that people travel and how they're using the service vary wildly between those locations. In San Francisco, we're finding that like 36% of people are actually using the service to connect with transit, you know, which is really surprising for us. So that's like, depending on where they are in the city, it could be like about a 3-mile ride to get to a transit or to get to work. Other people are using it to run errands and to doctor's appointments. So it really depends. And when you talk about the economics, you know, we're a premium service. And so people are, you know, paying for the consistency and the safety of the Waymo driver in the Waymo One service.
Under the sort of co-CEO model, you're really focused on the commercialization of what Waymo's been doing for quite a long time. And just going back to what you just said, yeah, I use Waymo often. I also use Tesla's FSD Supervised and was using Cruise. And, you know, the experience is interesting, but I'm trying to think about how I would use it in the course of my normal life. And for me, SFO is a big thing. So when am I going to be able to go down to SFO in a Waymo from here on Pier 3 Embarcadero? And what's the progress you're making there?
Yeah, so, you know, when we launched in Phoenix, one of the early engagements was with the Phoenix Sky Harbor Airport. And so now we offer 24/7 pickup at the curbside there. You know, it's a process. We were the first autonomous vehicle company to receive FAA approval to be able to do that kind of pickup. And so we're deeply engaged with SFO officials so that we can do exactly that kind of pickup. The other thing that we're also deeply engaged in with our employees right now is fully autonomous rides on freeways because, you know, people want to take trips to and from the airport and they want to do it on freeways. And so we have that going in Phoenix. We have it also in San Francisco with our employees right now. And both of those are really critical unlocks for us. And we're really focused on it right now. And, you know, doing everything with safety at the center of how we move, it's iterative, it's deliberate, and it takes what it takes to get it right.
Let's dwell on that safety, Tekedra, and thank you for joining us today. Because S&P actually, kudos to you, calling out Waymo as the front runner in the field of AVs in the United States. But they do say challenges remain, including an ongoing investigation from the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration. How are you discussing that? How are you looking at your safety data?
So we're really, really proud. I mean, we, you know, founded in 2009 as the Google Self-Driving Car Project. Our company culture is built around safety, and it's built around the transparency of our safety. You know, there's not one measure of safety, so we've built a lot of measures and a lot of transparency. And last week, we launched the Safety Hub, and we're the only company that's sort of putting all of our data out there for academics, the media, everyone to engage with it and understand why it is that we know that we are, through the data, improving road safety. You just had some of the stats up, right? Like reducing the number of airbag deployments, injury causing crashes. I mean, this is why we exist, right? Level 4 technology should make the road safer for humans, for pedestrians, for cyclists, vulnerable road users. And we're showing that that's the case, but we're still, with the NHTSA investigation, engaging, demonstrating that, you know, engaging at every level of government is what you have to do when you're the first to do this. No one's reached this level of scale. And so we understand NHTSA has a role to play, and we also have a role to play in being very transparent.
And for that, you need money. And luckily, you got a large amount of it, $5 billion coming from Alphabet. Just tell us about the investment needs, the focus of that. S&P again calling out the need for this sort of capital investment to drive the U.S. forward.
Yeah, so super fortunate to be backed by Alphabet as well as our other external investors. You know, we're laser focused on scaling this technology. And so that investment, while it's a big number, doesn't represent a significant growth in our overall trajectory because we've been very diligent about bringing down our cost structure over time. And so you saw us in the last couple of weeks introduce our sixth generation driver. When you see us introducing a new technology or a new approach to our go-to-market strategy, one of the things that you can think about is that's going to make scaling our business more efficient over time. And so that's what we're really focused on doing, and having the backing of Alphabet is a great, great place to be.
Tekedra, what's your relationship like with Ruth Porat? I had my sort of final quarterly earnings call with her at the last call, and she's focused on other things now. How will you work together as she kind of transitions to a different function at Alphabet?
Yeah, so Ruth is going to remain involved, right? She's taking on this role as president and chief investment officer, and we are obviously a really important investment for Alphabet. And so she's been involved since I joined the company. She's a very, very ardent supporter of Waymo, and I look forward to continuing to work with her in this new capacity.
Tekedra, as you know, I kind of have a hands-on experience of your competitive landscape. What do you make of sort of Tesla's strategy with robo-taxi and a proprietary ride-hailing app? And also, why sort of is your approach different and going to succeed to them or to a Cruise, for example?
You know, this sort of question of competitive landscape, I think, is so interesting because we are in the business of trying to make the road safer. And we are in the business of doing it in a way that takes the human out of the loop for two reasons. One is it expands the number of people who have access to mobility options, right? If you don't need a driver's license, if you don't have to sit behind the wheel, then Waymo's a perfect opportunity for you. And hopefully any level four that actually, any level four system that actually makes, you know, the road safer will be that. And so that's the way we think about it. And so when I think about some of the other approaches that people are taking, I think if you need a driver's license or if the human has to take over, it's just very different. And it's not, you know, we're heads down focused on our strategy, which is a level four technology.